This is Duke University.
I'm Helen Salter, and I'm delighted that we're all here together this morning to launch what actually is a new program, a program called Citizen Journalists in the Middle East and North African Regions. It is a collaboration that we have been very excited to put together between the Middle East Studies Center, the Islamic Studies Center, and the Center for French and Francophone Studies, which I direct. And we are lucky to benefit from the support of the Franklin Humanities Center and the Office of Public Affairs and Government Relations, thanks to Deborah Jensen and Michael Schoenfeld for their continuing support of this effort, which we all feel is more and more timely here and in the many regions in North Africa, and specifically Tunisia, that we will address today. I have to say, before handing off to our co-collaborator, Erda Göknar, the director of Middle East Studies Center, we're thrilled that the first fellow that we're welcoming in this program, which we look forward to developing over the next set of years, is our colleague Amna Guellali, the lawyer who runs the main Bureau of Human Rights Watch in Tunis for Tunisia and Algeria. Erda.
Thank you, Helen. Welcome, everybody, to today's event entitled Hashtag Journalism and Social Movements in Tunisia. This event is part of a two-week residency by Dr. Amna Guellali, who's Tunisia and Algeria researcher for Human Rights Watch. Dr. Guellali does the vital, important work of investigating human rights abuses, producing detailed reports, news releases, and op-eds, and engages in local and international advocacy. Her residency bridges the long-standing Duke Media Fellows program and a new series that Helen just mentioned, entitled Citizen Journalists in the Middle East and North Africa. Building on the legacy of the Media Fellows program, the Citizen Journalists Project broadens the definition of journalist to include people without formal journalism training, but who have nonetheless compiled an impressive corpus of newsworthy content. Widespread access to social media platforms inspires many global citizens to become investigative journalists, reporting on events and crises beyond the resources and restrictions of traditional media outlets. In Tunisia, which has the highest democracy index ranking of any Middle Eastern country, citizen activists such as Dr. Guellali, who's the key member of today's panel, have monitored the implementation of political promises and empowered and informed citizens to take an active, central role in public debate. She's joined by Thomas DeGeorges, senior program coordinator for DUMESC and DISC, who has worked and conducted research in Tunis, and Alyssa Miller, a doctoral candidate in cultural anthropology, whose work focuses on the Tunisian Revolution. Please welcome our moderator, Robin Kirk, who is faculty co-chair of the Executive Committee of the Duke Human Rights Center at the Franklin Humanities Institute, and I'll turn it over to Robin.
I just wanted to, hey y'all, to lay out how this panel is going to go, and as Erdog mentioned, I'm involved with the Duke Human Rights Center at the Franklin Humanities Institute. I still consider myself a journalist, and I used to cover Peru and Colombia in the 1980s for American press, and then was a Human Rights Watch researcher for many years in Peru and Colombia. So welcome a new colleague, Amna, to Duke. I think I just want to say one quick thing, that this discussion could not be more timely. And could not be more connected to a lot of the questions that many people around the world are asking about what happens next. And I think the role of citizen journalists is going to be even more important as we move forward. And just think about some of the recent stories in the news just this past couple of weeks. So much has depended on citizen journalists recording, posting, forwarding other people's posts from places like the Dakota Access Pipeline or Paris or places in Colombia close to my heart because of the debate over the new Colombian peace accords. Our understanding of what's happening in the world is so enriched by the action of citizen journalists, And I really look forward to taking this opportunity to have this discussion on how this is working in Tunisia, and then also connecting this question to what faces us all as citizens as we move forward. What I'm going to do is I'm going to have Thomas speak first, then Amna, and then Alyssa. I've asked them both to keep it relatively brief so that we can really spend most of our time on discussion. So please do, as you're listening, think of questions, or we really welcome your additions to this discussion. Your citizens, too, we want to have your points of view and your engagement here. So do think of this as more of a discussion than something that you just have to kind of passively listen to. We'll be inviting that once our panelists have finished. So thank you very much all for coming.
I will keep this roughly to about 5 minutes. I may go over by 1 minute or so. I wanted to, as a historian, provide you with a little bit of context to go back before the revolution and talk a bit about how Tunisia was on the eve of the revolution. Prior to the revolution, Tunisia, for much of its post-colonial history, it was a former protectorate of France, had two presidents. The first, Habib Bourguiba, was the president immediately after independence. He steered the country through a series of what were known as self-autonomy accords, and later was replaced in a bloodless coup by his successor, Zine El Abidine Ben Ali. So if you can just imagine, Tunisia received its independence in 1956. From 1956 through 2011, two chief executives of the country. Compare it with the United States, perhaps, during that period, and you'll see what someone has called really constitutionalism without legitimacy, and also the authoritarian syndrome, as French scholars have called this. For those interested in learning more about either man and their legacy, I list two books that are sort of classics in the field. The Tragedy of Longevity, Bourguiba actually lived into his 90s, even after he was deposed, by Derek Hopwood. And then for our Francophone friends in the audience, Notre Ami Ben Ali, by an investigative French journalist who also wrote books about the Moroccan monarchy. I mentioned at the bottom Leila Ben Ali, née Trabelsi, and her family. And we'll get into this a little bit. But Ben Ali, for much of his reign, ruled Tunisia alongside a very powerful first lady. And her family also was quite influential. Tunisia's economic history, just a few points to make here. For those of you who are studying political economy or who are familiar with it, Tunisia, like most post-colonial states in the Middle East and indeed in the Third World, vacillated between policies that could be described as socialist and also neoliberal. Oftentimes, neoliberal policies emerged in the 70s and 80s at the behest of global institutions such as the IMF and the World Bank. Tunisia's major sources of revenue, phosphates, olive oil, tourism, and also remittances, mostly from Western Europe, countries like France, countries like Germany. During the Ben Ali years, there was more of an emphasis, at least publicly, on neoliberal policies. However, for those familiar with the Syrian situation, the family, right, was paramount. The family of the president, much like in the case in Egypt and in Syria, held key positions and oftentimes held a stranglehold on key sectors of the economy, such as media and such as tourism and industry. That said, right, there is an emphasis all too often to sort of throw away the Ben Ali years as a black spot entirely, 100%. Ben Ali in some ways created the seeds of his own demise by focusing on creating a knowledge economy designed to attract European investors. And by so doing, by the 2000s, Tunisia had one of the highest internet penetration and the largest mobile phone networks throughout Africa, setting the stage for the Arab Spring in 2011. I want to talk, and this is more for the discussion period, about the social challenges that Tunisia may be facing in the future. The first is what to do with defavorized regions, what to do with the central and interior regions of Tunisia, which have historically not benefited from much of the investment and tourism revenue of the coastal areas. How to promote employment among the long-term unemployed. Many of these issues should be familiar to all of you after this particularly contentious presidential election in the United States. And Tunisia deals with this as well. What is the legacy of authoritarianism? What punishment for collaborators? Morocco and Algeria prior to Tunisia have actively tried to address these issues. Tunisia has had two commissions to date on this, and perhaps some of our other panelists will want to address this in more detail. Reform of the police force. This is an especially important issue and linked to the last one I mentioned. How can the police, the forces of law and order, better serve the citizenry and not just a dictator and his family? University tensions and teacher-student relations. Oftentimes, these sorts of things, many of the things that many of you deal with in this room, are also quite important for Tunisian administrators, teachers, and students, especially the issue of Islam in public life. Whether to wear the veil, the hijab, whether to wear the full veil, the niqab, to school is a decision of great personal import and is often hotly debated on campuses. And finally, I'll raise the issue of psychological trauma during and following the revolution. This is often an understated issue. It's one that's not often covered. And I think that, you know, I would be interested to hear your thoughts on this, and perhaps in a comparative way, maybe we can reach a consensus. With that, my time is up. I do have more slides. Perhaps we'll have an opportunity to come back to them in the Q&A.
Well, hello, everyone. Thank you all for being here, and I would like to thank the Center for Roman Studies, the Middle East Center, the Human Rights Center, and all those who made my coming here and my stay at Duke possible and wonderful, because I'm really learning a lot and having a great time here. I think my talk would be more focused on internet, Facebook use as a tool for mobilizing social and political forces in Tunisia. And thank you very much, Tom, because you gave really a great context to this, to the historical, you know, like elements that made, you know, like this revolution possible. Because I think your indicators and the questions you asked in this presentation are key for you know, like understanding what happened for this revolution and then what are the challenges ahead. And we can of course address some of these in the discussion. As Tom mentioned, Tunisia has one of the biggest or largest internet penetration in Africa and in the Middle East. And I think Facebook is really the key, you know, like social media in Tunisia, much more than Twitter, much more than other social media. Just to give you one indicator, out of a population of 11 million people, there are 6 million Facebook users and Facebook accounts. So this shows, you know, like the importance of Facebook. And I think the social media in Tunisia played a very important role, both during the dictatorship, during the revolution, and after the revolution, during the transition and the democracy building and constitution drafting processes. And I would like to very briefly, you know, like give an overview about this historical role that Facebook and social media gave in Tunisia. So before the revolution, as Tom was mentioning, it was a dictatorship, and it was a very strict. There was a very strict censorship on internet, on social media in Tunisia, Facebook, despite the fact that there were a lot of Facebook users and internet users, but the dictatorship and the authoritarian regimes through different institutions were able to have a stranglehold on the internet and to prevent users from accessing to many of the internet pages that were important for the for discussing, you know, like political issues and for dissent. Despite this, I think there was some space for dissent that the activists created for themselves. And there were a lot of activists, a lot of citizen journalists using internet to create pages to, you know, like express their dissent, to express criticism toward the regime, etc. Some of them were imprisoned and for long years. One very well known, I don't know if Tom remembers him, but Zuhair Yahyawi, who was created one of the best, you know, like pages criticizing the government and Ben Ali, but then he was prosecuted and sentenced to 3 years in prison. He died really shortly after because he had very bad health conditions in prison. So despite this censorship, there was an attempt to create, you know, like some space and to open the space for dissent in the country through internet. And this these attempts culminated in 2010. So right before the revolution, which started in December 2010, in May 2010, there was a big movement called, I will say it in Arabic, Ya Ammar Sayyib Saleh. And it means that the censorship system in Tunisia was given a name, the name of Ammar, you know, like a mythical, you know, like a personality that is fictitious. And it's Ammar, give us a break. It's in order to signal to, you know, like the white public, the willingness of this young people, the youth in Tunisia, to open the space for dissent and for criticism. And it was extraordinary to see for the first time, you know, like thousands of young people sharing on Facebook their photos with this slogan, Ammar, give us a break. And in the open, without, you know, like covering their faces. And this was really one of the first, you know, like campaigns that helped open the space for dissent. Now, as I said, shortly after that, there was what happened, you know, like on the 17th of December 2010, a street vendor set himself on fire to protest against police violence and police, you know, like confiscation of his goods, the only ones that he had in order to make a living. And he, this movement set a popular protest that was later called, you know, like the Jasmine Revolution in Tunisia and the Arab Spring elsewhere. And I think without internet, without Facebook, without the social media, this revolution wouldn't have reached its apex with the fall of the regime and wouldn't have succeeded because there were many popular protests before, especially one in 2008, with a lot of, you know, like with an uprising as well. But it was crushed, and it was crushed mainly because the authorities and the government was able to seal off these regions from media coverage, because the media was state media, it was controlled by the state, and there was, you know, like an impossibility to cover these events. So these regions were completely sealed off from the media, and this has helped isolate them and prevent the propagation of the protest movement. In 2010, 2011, the situation was completely different. As I said, Facebook users started to, you know, like share on their pages a lot of the videos of the protests and a lot of the, you know, like videos also of the violence from the state. Just very quickly, I want to go now to the post-revolution. And I think Facebook continued and the internet, the social media continued to play a very important role during the transition and the democratic process. Just to give you an example of this, when during the drafting of the constitution, some of the Islamist forces attempted to put in the constitution an article that was not in conformity with international human rights standards on women's rights. So an article that created you know, like a new concept for women's rights, the concept of complementarity. So women being complementary to men, there was you know, like an uproar and a big, you know, like scandal. This created uproar in Tunisia, and this also was there was a mobilization on the internet and on Facebook with a hashtag called "Equal and Not Complementary," and this has you know, like drained a lot of attention and also helped in mobilizing, you know, like the women and men also who support women's causes on the streets to put pressure on the, you know, like those drafting the constitution to eliminate this concept. And this has happened indeed. So I think that social movements, I mean, social media has really a very important role. And I have many other examples, but I leave it to that. And we can discuss it further during the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you to the organizers of this event. Thank you, everyone, for attending. And mostly, I wanted to thank Amna for being here with us today. I'm really excited to have her with us so that we can learn from her experience. So Amna has just given us a good overview of the importance that social media played in the days of the revolution and in the days that followed. And I'm sure that this is probably not the first time that you've been exposed to certain theses about the revolutionary potential of social media during the 2011 Dignity Revolution. What I'd like to do here is, rather than rehashing those arguments, I'd like to highlight the role that independent youth continue to play in shaping key political battles in Tunisia's democratic transition, and its capacity to mobilize citizens, civil society, and political parties around a common goal. I'd like to talk about a specific example, which is a protest movement called Manish Musama. Manish Musama means "I do not pardon" or "I do not forgive" in Tunisian Arabic. Manish Musama is a horizontal network of Tunisian youth activists who united over the course of 2015 to 2016 around a project law on financial and economic reconciliation. This law, which was sponsored by President Bejikai Disepsi, was a direct attack on the mandate of the Truth and Dignity Commission to adjudicate crimes of corruption committed under the Ben Ali regime. The Ben Ali regime, as you know, has been widely exposed and denounced as a kleptocracy that profited by usurping public monies and goods during the course during the 23 years of his reign in Tunisia. So this law was touted as a way to renew confidence in an economy mired in crisis. But the project law proposed that crimes of corruption be adjudicated by a closed commission overseen by the executive branch rather than the Truth and Dignity Commission. So this process completely lacked transparency and would enable crony capitalists to be rehabilitated without their crimes, without disclosing their crimes to the public. Given the law's contentious nature, the president submitted it to parliament on June 15th, 2015. So this was in the middle of Ramadan, in the middle of summer, and under the cover of an official state of emergency that placed limits on public demonstrations. So this timing clearly shows that the president was hoping that the law would pass unopposed and that it would be basically unnoticed by the public, okay? Manish Musama mobilized to defeat this law specifically to protect the Truth and Dignity Commission as an institution of transitional justice and to defend against a culture of impunity from creeping back in due to public fatigue after several turbulent years of political transition. I want to look now specifically, since the theme is hashtag journalism, I wanted to look specifically at some of the media tactics that contributed to Manish Musama's success. Firstly, the phrase Manish Musama functions pretty brilliantly as a hashtag, as a slogan, and as a verbal and visual meme. So the phrase itself is taken from a children's playground rhyme, which says that Asmah fil Makama, which means in Arabic, forgiveness takes place in the courthouse. Okay, and that slogan, Asmah fil Makama, is written on that banner, as you see the Manish Musama people protesting in a protest march on Habib Bourguiba Street. This was in the summer of 2016. So I think through this phrase, forgiveness takes place in the courthouse, the movement really captures a child's headstrong and innocent insistence on both justice and the rule of law, right? And so over the course of a year and a half, this project law functioned kind of like a zombie in the sense that it kept resurfacing after it seemed to have been defeated, right? Because the president kept resubmitting it to parliament. So I first encountered this movement in 2015 during field work over the summer, and I was pretty surprised to come back a year later in summer 2016 and to find that this movement was still fighting the same battle, right? That the law had been resubmitted to parliament, basically unchanged, and so that people were continuing to have to protest the same law. So let's see. Another tactic that they used, in addition to using Manish Massema as a hashtag online on Twitter and on Facebook, they also used it as a graffiti tag. So here you see the slogan Manish Massema in the streets of Tunis. And here it kind of functioned as an advertisement or as an overture to an upcoming protest march or street action. Another great example is the Wanted campaign, which started in the summer of 2016. And this was a direct attempt or a direct response to attempts at laundering figures associated with the Ben Ali regime through manipulative and flattering appearances on political talk shows. So these posters kind of popped up overnight. So the activists would print these up and they would paste them on public walls in the streets of Tunis and do it under cover of night. So people maybe would wake up in the morning, they'd be catching the metro to go to work, and they would see the names and the faces of old regime figures appearing on the walls, like, and reminding people that these people haven't actually gone to trial yet for the crimes of usurping public monies, for example, or for their participation in the Ben Ali regime. And so, so what's really nice about these posters is that they appeared in public space, but the group Manish Massema also posted them online on Facebook. So if you saw the action in Tunis and you were living in a different city, let's see, like, say, Gafsa or Bizerte, and you wanted to repeat the action, you could download this poster and then post it on the walls of your own city. So in this way, they kind of encouraged the slogans and the posters to go viral, in a sense, both online, but then also offline. So Manish Massema was ultimately successful in reclaiming the right to public protest in defiance of the state emergency law in fall of 2015. And furthermore, the matter of the project law has now finally been settled by Parliament just really recently in October of 2016. When it was declared that the law would not be taken under review by Parliament. However, the slogan Manish Massema lives on in Tunisian publics as a powerful rejoinder to corruption, political amnesia, and any betrayal of the dignity revolution's ideals.
I'm going to totally exploit my position as moderator to ask the first question. But I, you know, one of the threads that's going through all three of your presentations was the not only the internet and a history of protests, but also this question of the youth. What, and I wonder if you could each respond to how and why you think young people became energized in this way, and was it more on the basis of a political engagement, or were there also cultural issues that galvanized youth interest in politics? So maybe Thomas, you could start on that.
I think again, am I wearing my hat as historian? I mean, I think that there are historical sort of trends that make each generation of Tunisian youth since independence likely to at least consider some sort of political engagement. Tunisia is a colonial, former colonial possession of France, fought its way to independence, not in as bloody way as neighboring Algeria, but nevertheless, youth movements since the beginning of, since the 1930s and 40s, under the party, the neo-destour, destour in Arabic is constitution, of Bourguiba, youth were always privileged and prized as the shock troops, if you will, of mass nationalist parties. So I do think that there are cultural and historical reasons why, you know, youth, you know, would get involved in politics. For more current matters, I mean, I think I'll turn it over to any of my colleagues over here.
Yeah. Should I go ahead? Yeah. I think, yeah, the issue of, or the role of youth in post-revolutionary Tunisia is really very interesting because I think after the revolution, you know, like a lot of people, including young people, engaged in the political life, but then were very quickly disillusioned and disenchanted with, you know, like the political life and with the parties in which they all, you know, like tried to engage. And so there was quickly a kind of disenchantment that came after their engagement in politics. And I think a lot of them turned to civil society groups and to these forms of activism that were not, you know, like institutional political engagement, but were more ad hoc, more spontaneous, etc. And I think what Alyssa was showing, and I think it was really a great presentation, is the way in which these young people are trying to keep alive the spirit of the revolution. Because you know that it's very, after, you know, like an uprising, after a revolution, it's true that there is a strong engagement, a strong, you know, like hope in changing the situation, in changing the dynamics. And this hope very quickly, of course, because of the constraints, because of the, you know, like the political system and the difficulties in bringing through and implementing these, you know, like demands, becomes much more difficult to implement. And you have to deal with the realities of the political system and the political institutions. But these movements in Tunisia, I think, were very much alert at the risk of, you know, like disengagement of the youth and the return of the former regime in several, you know, like forms, morphing into new institutions, new political parties, etc. So I think these kind of, you know, like these kind of social movements and these kind of mobilizing forces from young people in Tunisia were really in order to keep like this revolutionary spirit alive, and that's how they, I think, try to energize their forces.
Yeah, I just want to maybe build on what Amna has mentioned and say that I think that this revolution, the youth really feel that it is their revolution, and I think it's quite true when you think about how the revolution really emerged. I think we can say very sort of schematically thinking from two particular rifts in this image that Ben Ali had very successfully over the course of his 23 years of rule, banding about as Tunisia's sort of economic miracle of Tunisia as being a country that is moderate, that is characteristically moderate, that's Western friendly, that's completely unified, and that is largely middle class, and that structurally speaking, provides widespread opportunities for a certain kind of economic security for most of their citizens. And now I think that one of the rifts or the cracks in this veneer from which the revolution then emerged would be a generational rift, in the sense that if you look at unemployment figures, you see that it's largely, I mean, there's been a long-standing unemployment crisis in Tunisia that's been building and deepening for quite some time now. But it disproportionately affects the young, and it disproportionately affects the young who are university degree holders, right? So I think that it seemed pretty clear for this generation that, you know, they were kind of excluded or locked out of the system in a lot of different ways. The system maybe worked for some people, but it wasn't working for them, right? And so I think that a lot of the slogans of the revolution, when you think about how people were calling for dignity, that notion of dignity is also really wrapped up, I think, in the right to work and to have a kind of acceptable job that is at the same level as your qualifications. So I think that's just one way in which, and not to mention the fact that it was largely youth bodies that were in the streets being exposed to the security apparatus and in some cases dying or being wounded during the days of the revolution. So I think that the youth really feel like a lot of their demands have not necessarily been met because they're structural demands that are difficult to rectify. But I think also, so I think that they feel that they were the main revolutionary subjects and that perhaps it's their role also to defend it and to try and make sure that it has some kind of success. And there's been a lot of disappointment, I think, since 2011. I think the other thing that I would say is that this sense of being a generation locked out of participation or locked out of inclusion is something that carries over into the political parties. So I know that when I speak with youth activists, including some who are involved in something like Manish Misama, some of them are people who were, citizen journalists who were maintained blogs and things that were very popular during the revolution, and some of them have become fairly well-known public figures through that form of activism. But others of them are persons who were involved in politics, kind of like with some leftist communist parties, Jebe Shabia, for example, the Popular Front, and kind of felt dissatisfied in the sense that the older generation is always giving the commands and then the youth are used as a kind of foot soldier to mobilize political action, but they're never the decision makers. And so a lot of people felt like they're more attracted to something sort of independent and non-hierarchical, so that they have a kind of space for participation in political life.
Thank you. Questions, comments?
What is the prognosis moving forward? So it seems as though things have arrived at an in-between, or a state of progression, and there's now a lot of people who've exposed their views in a new government arrangement. And what do you see the next steps being? Is this a forward direction that gets better? Is there danger in the sense that, I mean, I'm asking an absurd question because nobody knows these things, but is there a danger in that the government could become more authoritarian, and then all of this would be a liability for those people who have now become known? What are your thoughts on that?
Who wants to take that?
Yeah, I can address this. Thank you for your question. I think for the next steps, what I can see clearly now in Tunisia is this chasm between the institutional, legal, constitutional, you know, like democracy building process that was moved forward and was able to, complete in a way, or at least to have, a democratic transition that is hailed internationally as successful, and rightly so, because there were some very significant steps that were completed, such as, the drafting of the constitution, free and transparent presidential and legislative elections in 2014, and, an institution building process that is on its way and will definitely, if it is carried on with this pace, could, you know, like have, could create, you know, like a very good framework for a new democracy, a burgeoning, emerging democracy. But on the other hand, when you have a reality check and you see what happens on the ground, you see that there is a big, you know, like disconnect between this institutional, you know, like legislative framework and the reality of the economic and security situation in the country. And so a lot of these, you know, like regions and people who were at the heart of the revolution, who went out on the streets in popular protests and called for, as you said, dignity, for equality, for a dignified life, for better, you know, like social and economic conditions, a lot of them feel completely disenfranchised and completely marginalized in this process. And the economic situation will weigh very deeply on this process moving forward, because this, you know, like complete disconnection or chasm between the institutional political building process and then the economic situation and the situation of the people who were at the heart of the revolution will continue to grow. And there will be at some point, I think, if there is no major change in the policy of the government, in the, you know, like the economic vision towards these regions and towards some of these people, I think it will be definitely a risk of, you know, like another uprising or another big, you know, like social movement that would this time not maybe be as peaceful as it was during the first revolution, so the 2011 revolution. And we have started already to see some of these indicators, you know, like there is social unrest in various parts of the country with a lot of social movements, with a lot of discontent from the people on the streets. So as we move forward, I think this is one of the major challenges for Tunisia's stability and for keeping the democratic process on track. And I think the only solution for this is really to redesign the economic legal framework and to have, you know, like these disadvantaged regions, you know, like being brought back into the economic economical dynamics. But on that level, I think that we are facing a big challenge as well, because, you know, like Tunisia is not alone. Tunisia has to cope with international, you know, like institutions that are, you know, like forcing it basically to have a neoliberal approach to the economy. So there is this tension, and it's not very clear where we are heading right now.
Other questions?
I had a two-part question. The first one is, how would you compare, I mean, relatively speaking, Tunisia is a success story if you look at the other Arab Spring countries and the legacies of those upheavals. So what forces do you think were at play in Tunisia that somehow collapsed or did not prevail in these other cases of Libya, Egypt, Syria, maybe? And the second part is I was hoping one of you could give me a sense of the landscape of the political parties. What are the main ideological factions that are vying for political control today?
Maybe Thomas, you could take that first one.
I'd be happy to take the first part of our desk question. Why Tunisia? And some people have characterized it, what went wrong? So once the revolution or the revolutionary sort of fervor moved to Libya and Egypt, I've thought a lot about that. And I think that to some degree, Tunisia benefited from being the first. One of the most shocking things was, if you canvass political scientists, if you canvass people, scholars who work on Tunisia, in 2010, absolutely no one would have predicted, to my knowledge, that Ben Ali would be swept out of power within weeks. From 2010, as Alyssa mentioned, December 2010 to January 2011, absolutely nobody. So I think that to some degree, the dictatorship, the forces in place that Ben Ali had put The RCD, which was the mass party, the army, which is relatively small, the police force, which actually in the aftermath of the revolution turned out to be a shadow of what most people had estimated it to be, really, you know, had difficulty understanding first who these protesters were and then how to deal with them. The international community, I think Tunisia also benefited from the fact that, frankly, it doesn't figure much in geopolitical games. I mean, it's not a Syria. It's not a Lebanon. It's not an Egypt. You know, I think that to some degree, it was easier for the Obama administration, for the French, to say, give these people a voice. I think what you find is after Tunisia, after the Arab Spring in Tunisia, you find that, really quite sadly, you know, there was a sort of a dictatorship learning curve. And whether you, when you move to Egypt, when you move to Syria especially, the brutality that was launched against protesters goes up significantly. Guellali made three speeches and then left. I mean, sort of the three strikes and you're out, if you like baseball. And Mubarak also left relatively quickly, but the deep state in places like Egypt and Syria, I think really learned. I mean, they learned what not to do almost from Guellali's mistakes.
Who wants to take this? Yeah,
just to add to what Tom has said, in terms of the what are the major maybe differences or some of the dynamics at play in Tunisia that made it possible to have a successful transition, I think to add to what you said, one of the major also differences is also the fact that Tunisia doesn't have, like in other countries, like so if you compare it with Egypt, for example, you know, like this very important institution, which is the army, which played a very significant role both in Syria, in Egypt, and in Libya to crash the revolution and to kill people and you know, like have all these like massacres going on, in addition to ousting, you know, like an elected president, like the case in Egypt. In Tunisia, we didn't have, you know, like this situation because the army was quite sidelined by the regime of both Bourguiba and Guellali, because they feared that the army would be, you know, like would turn against them, so they sidelined it, and the police forces were only, you know, like always serving, you know, like the regime, but didn't have this major role like in Egypt, for example, or other Middle East countries that went through the Arab Spring. So I think this is one of the, you know, like major maybe differences. And this has left the space, you know, like open for other forces of moderation to come in and play the role of brokers of peace. And I think here of the role of the civil society. I think civil society really came into this process and at the height of political divides and political crisis in Tunisia in order to bridge the gap between the different political parties and forces at play, and was able in a way to keep the you know, like the process on track, because we went through a lot of crises that could have, you know, like that brought the country on the brink of a civil war and could have really derailed the whole process. But the force of civil society was really one of the major elements that prevented this. And I think here of the crisis in 2013 after political the assassination of two political leftist leaders by extremist groups. After this this crisis, you know, like after these assassinations, there was a big crisis in the country, with opposition leaders calling for another party, so the Islamist party, to step down from power and relinquish power. And there was, you know, like a kind of a stalemate for a long time until civil society groups came together and tried to broker, you know, like an agreement between these political parties. And as you know, I mean, I'm sure many of you know that these civil society groups won then the Nobel Peace Prize in 2015. 2015, and they were formed by major, groups in Tunisia, such as the Union for Tunisian Labor, the Labor Union, and the League of Human Rights and the Bar Association. These are some of the groups that made it possible to overcome some of the crises. So this is one, I think, also a major difference, because when you compare it to other countries and other places like Egypt, Syria, and Libya, I mean, civil society was completely crashed and was not, even during the time when it was able to mobilize, this niche of time very quickly closed down with, the repression, like in Egypt, and with, massive killing also and imprisonment, like in the case of Syria.
Yeah, right in front here.
Recently, in the United States, especially with this election, we've seen a surge in the role of media, but especially social media, in how the public opinion of national and political issues is structured and formed. And with this surge of the role of social media, also have seen an increase in news outlets, both far right and far left, that give completely false information and kind of turn an uninformed public into a misinformed public. And that creates has created a lot of division in this election and just in general. And obviously, from what I've heard, in Tunisia, the media has played a huge, and social media has played a huge role in informing the public that was prior to the use of Facebook, relatively uninformed. I was wondering if there's also the issue of media reliability and misinformation from either side.
Mm-hmm. Great question. Alyssa, do you want to take that?
Yeah, why don't I take that? And my answer might be partially anecdotal, but yeah, absolutely. In Tunisia, people refer to it like in French, news is called désinformation or info, they call it intox. Like, this isn't des info, but it's intoxic. It's like intox. It's kind of like poisoned news, right? Kind of garbage that gets circulated, right? And I think absolutely that happens in Tunisia, and I might talk about specific examples. I think you probably are all aware that Tunisia, during its transitional period, has been under attack also. There have been big terrorist attacks in 2015 on tourist installations. And what happens is that, there are firstly real security concerns, but under the cover of counterterrorism, there is this potential for real social movements, people asking for jobs or asking for increased transparency as it relates to the management of natural resources in the country. There's a real potential for these movements to be slandered as somehow associated with Islamist regimes or ISIS or being infiltrated by some kind of nefarious actors. And I think that you can see this. I have to say that the government themselves traffics in this kind of confusion. So, for example, after the attack on a tourist resort in Sousse in 2015 in the summer, Bejikai Desepsi went on air and he declared a state of emergency. And in response to the attacks, and he was talking about the counterterrorism imperative, but in the same breath, he talked about how we need to be able to free up the train lines so that we can move phosphates out of the phosphate mines in Gafsa to the ports in Gebez. Now, the phosphate lines were blocked because of social contention, because there were protesters sitting on those lines and their protests had to do with jobs, right? So there's a sense in which, and those people were broken up shortly thereafter. So there's a sense in which the government themselves have used the state of emergency to kind of declare social movements also a security concern, right? So we need to get the phosphates out of GAFSA, so we under counterterrorism sort of imperatives. Another example that I can think of is that there have been, a kind of complicated set of sit-ins happening on a cluster of islands called Kerkena, just outside a major city called Sfax. And this is a social sit-in. There's a British petroleum company called Petrofac that's installed and exploiting offshore oil around the islands. And apparently at some point, as part of their concession, they had promised a certain number of jobs to local inhabitants of the islands. And those jobs haven't been received, like no one's been hired under that kind of like social offer. And so people have been sitting in Kirkena. I'm not sure if they're still there, but they were there for really months. And at some point, a Islamist group that has nothing to do with these protesters, it's called Hezb Tahrir, held a rally on the island also. And they look really scary. They almost look like they're affiliated with ISIS, but they're not, but they have the same black flag and everything. And so there was a lot of media sort of videos of these sort of Islamists on the island circulating, and people started saying that the sit-in was being run by like a caliphate of ISIS on Kirkena, right? Like Kirkena has been declared as a caliphate or something. So like that sounds kind of completely ridiculous, but I think that, you know, things are turbulent and changing and uncertain. And I think that it's easy for people's fears to be manipulated, right? And so like, absolutely, I do think that you see the same use of social media, the kind of ease with which you can capture a video, but then caption it to say whatever you want, to stoke people's fears that a social movement with legitimate grievances, social grievances, might actually be some kind of shadowy forces, right?
Amna, you want to go?
Yeah, just to add to what you were saying, which I mean, great examples of, you know, how the media has you know, like the ability and the force to manipulate and to transform, you know, like the reality and to misinform and disinform, you know, like the public, and as much as you see it in other places. But I think that Tunisia's example is quite, you know, like specific, because it's a country that didn't have for a long time, you know, like free media. And it was a state-controlled media with only one or two public televisions. The private televisions didn't have, you know, like that much leeway to cover the events, etc. Now, after the revolution, of course, there was a liberalization of the media space. There was the adoption of a new press code and audiovisual media code in 2011 that really removed some of the criminalization, you know, like articles, so article criminalizing free speech, and kind of protected the space for freedom of expression and freedom of the media. However, this does not really lead in a fast track, you know, like fashion to a real free media. I don't think there is, you know, like the legal and political space is necessary, but that does not translate immediately in a media landscape which is objective, impartial, really gives voice to the different, you know, like forces at play, etc. Because what happened immediately after the revolution with the proliferation of these new, you know, like televisions and radios is that they were kind of controlled by people who were aligned with either Ben Ali before or after the demise of Ben Ali with new, you know, like governments, with the new government. So they control, in a way, the narrative. They shape the narrative about a lot of things, including on social movements. And the fact that these media outlets and these you know, TV stations are controlled by businessmen who are aligned with either former regime or the new government with its, you know, like official discourse, makes it difficult for alternative, you know, like discourses to be heard. And that's why it is very important. The social media space in Tunisia is really very important because it's the only one that kind of offers, you know, like this this alternative narrative about social movements, protests, etc., that counter, you know, like the official discourse, which is all the time aired on TV and makes and shapes really very strongly the public opinion against social movements and against, because they are fear-mongering, as you said, and this has really played out in a negative way during some of these protests.
I just have a couple questions, and I'd like to step back a little bit from the Tunisian level at this particular question that you asked, mm-hmm. to sort of look at social media more broadly for a bit. As Amna was saying, there is no free media and there's no free social media. And for all of the philanthropic work that people at the upper echelons of Facebook, at Twitter, and of YouTube do, and Google, they are running businesses which have a very distinct model. And one of that model, one of the cores of that model, is to data mine everybody who uses their platforms. What I think people are coming to understand at the moment is that this data mining is leading to echo chambers in terms of political views, not just again in Tunisia, but you alluded to recent elections here. I was struck by your use of the word false. You said, well, these are false reports. Well, are they false reports? I mean, if these companies, and they are companies, have a business model to understand you as the consumer, they have to then understand your political preferences, they have to understand what your friends' political preferences are, and because this business model relies heavily on advertising, they've then got to figure out what to sort of push to you and your friends and your network. So you create a chamber here in which, you know, if you're on one side of a political divide, your social media platforms and your profile, and you have to think about this because so many of us just check on Facebook or Twitter, but it will push you, these algorithms and software running these platforms, it will push you increasingly biased or at least, you know, opinions that meet the approval, tacit approval of you and your social group, so that you wake up and say this happened or an election result went one way or the other, must be rigged or must be, you know. And I think that there's a growing understanding of this sort of back office side of social media. And again, I think it's these companies have done brilliant work, PR work, to sort of insulate themselves from a more sort of perceptive look about how they are actively, their business model influences our choices.
I think, just to add on to that, I think that as Mark Zuckerberg is a good example of this, I don't think even some of the, you know, top people in these businesses understand what the effect is and how that model is working out. We have a real unruly thing here in social media with, you know, if Zuckerberg is denying that, and I think you're, you know, there's part of, I understand what you're saying in the sense, part is right, that some of this stuff is very, there's some stuff that's opinion and there's some stuff that's just, it's propaganda, basically, to call it what it is. And that has become sort of normalized and also equalized in some social media platforms. Other questions? Yeah, Helen.
To bring it back one more time to our figure of the citizen journalist, I'd be curious to hear you talking about how both social media representatives of the citizen journalist and the still corrupt or compromised private media respond to other groups, some of whom you've alluded to, some of whom it would be wonderful to hear you talk about, more on women and their fight against sexual violence. The beginning of coverage of the LGBT communities in Tunisia. Mm-hmm. And also, I'm really curious how you see these figures addressing the constant flow of illegals, whether from sub-Saharan Africa or other places in Africa.
Thank you very much, Helen. I think these are really great questions that will allow us to, dig deeper into some of these issues that you mentioned. So I'm going to talk about two issues maybe. One is the women's rights and their fight against violence, and then the LGBT community and, how it is addressed in the media and in social media. On the issue of violence against women, especially, in the domestic sphere and also in the public sphere, I think that for a long time in Tunisia, these issues were not really, addressed, were not covered in a way that is orderly and is, provides a coverage that really furthers women's rights, because it was left to the media outlets' decision, which, as you know, I mean, what their coverage is usually marked by sensationalism and by, coverage which is for women's rights and protecting and respecting women's rights. So we had recently one of the examples of this sensationalism and coverage which is really very scandalous of these issues with respect to women's violence against women was in one private TV. There was, these talk shows or reality shows where the victims or people come forward and, ask for either the pardon of their family or reunion with their family, this kind of shows. And there was one lady who is, I think, 18 years old or 19 years old, who on TV revealed that she was raped by several members of her family, including an uncle, a cousin, etc., and that she became pregnant from someone of these people who raped her that she doesn't know. She doesn't know who is the father of her child. Or the baby. So, and what happened is that the commentator on TV, like the guy who leads this reality show, was blaming her. He blamed her for what happened and said that this, that she should ask her father to bring her back to the to their house, because she was kicked out of the house by her father, and she has to ask for his pardon, and that she should marry her rapist so that everything would come back into normal, And so this kind of comments is really coming from a deeply enrooted, vision of, these issues in terms of victim blaming and being, very harsh towards the victim and not toward the perpetrator or the rapist. But what was great in this, very tragic, incident in terms of how the media covered it, is that it set off a whole social movement against this this talk show and against the way this guy was blaming the victim and trying to make it different, trying to make a difference in terms of the discourse toward these kind of issues, especially, when it comes to women's honor and women's, bodies. And so this social movement became really very strong. It was widely shared on Facebook, and it led to the halting the this talk show for 3 months or 6 months, because there is in Tunisia there is an institution which supervises the media and is independent. It's not state controlled, and it has the right when the media doesn't respect a certain number of ethical principles. It has the right to, you know, like halt or stop some of the talk shows or other, you know, like media products. So this movement led also to, you know, like some very important and significant change in terms of the impact on the media, because they, you know, like the fact that it was stopped for a while and that this this talk show was singled out and considered as, you know, like not worthy of watching, etc., has really created a new dynamic and new way of covering, I think, these issues. So any other talk show will have to, you know, like very strictly look at the terms in which they are addressing these issues and not being so, you know, like victim blaming as for this talk show. In terms of the LGBT community, I think this is really one of the features of the, you know, like post-revolution Tunisia, is that a lot of communities, a lot of people that didn't have any visibility during the dictatorship and during the years of the repression, all of a sudden, of course, have the space, and they really engaged in terms of acquiring this space and creating, you know, like a visibility for themselves. So the LGBT community, I think, is really one of the examples of how they try to engage with the media and with the public opinion. They created, some of the LGBT communities created an NGO called CHEMS. And this NGO became very active and gave a lot of visibility to the LGBT community. They were, you know, like invited in primetime talk shows to talk about the this association, to talk about the community, to talk about their demands, etc. And it was quite unprecedented. And I think even compared to other, you know, like countries in the region, it's quite, you know, like unique, because I don't think there are many places in the Middle East where you can talk openly about an LGBT community and about, you know, like their demands, etc. But at the same time, it has created the backlash, because with the visibility of the LGBT community, there was also the attempt to crack down on it, to, you know, like to prevent them from talking and to prosecute them. So there were a lot of prosecutions following these, you know, like this increased media attention to the community. There were a lot of persecution later on because there was a backlash. And I think this is one of the tensions that you see. And that will be, I think, settled in on the long run, because the more there is visibility, the more there will be debate around these issues, and a debate that hopefully will not be, again, sensationalist and pitting people against each other on the idea ideological level. The more there will be, you know, like space for you know, like the major presence and increased presence for this community and other communities. I mean,
I just have, if I can ask your indulgence, I did have pictures, and one of these pictures actually relates directly to what Amna just mentioned about the LGBTQ community. As Amna was mentioning, there's often backlash when groups, slide. There's often backlash, and I apologize for the poor image here of the second picture on the right. One of the ways that LGBTQ communities deal with backlash, a strategy that has been used in the past, is to sort of bring in LGBTQ issues in the realm of public health. So what you're seeing here on the left is a statue of the Tunisian philosopher Ibn Khaldun, who hopefully most of you will know from a book he wrote, The Muqaddimah, a sort of treatise on Arab history and political science, sociology. HIV
groups, groups that combat HIV in Tunisia, at one point adopted his figure as, and using very cleverly Tunisian dialect here, Sida, right? Asida, which in French is HIV, is the word in red. And it reads roughly, even I'm concerned about HIV. Right? Meaning even Ibn Khaldun. And again, I apologize for the picture, but he is actually wearing, right? Or they have put, they've photoshopped a little ribbon on his cloak. So, yeah, I just wanted to say that in the, even with the backlash, you know, LGBTQ communities find very clever and creative ways to continue to advocate for these positions.
One more question, are we good? Great, well thank you, and please join me in thanking our great panelists. This was fascinating.